Welcome to Forward Obsessed, where we talk to breakthrough business leaders and rising entrepreneurs about their journeys, origin stories, and aha moments.
Hello, my Forward Obsessed fans and friends. On this episode, we spoke with Barry Nailbuff. Barry talked to us about negotiation, strategy, innovation, and building the Honest Tea Company, which he eventually went with his partner and sold to Coca-Cola. Barry's got an incredible background, and he's going to talk to you about strategy, negotiation, some of the key tips and tricks to do that. He's going to take us on an amazing journey of his career, ranging from some of the most prestigious academic universities in the world, with Oxford and Harvard and Yale University, where he's a professor now on economics and game theory. Definitely want to check out this episode. Enjoy. Welcome back, everybody, to Forward Obsessed. Got a really awesome guest today, Barry Nailbuff, entrepreneur, professor, really, really, really great, humble, but also smart and strategic guy. So welcome to the podcast.
Yeah, humble is not the word people normally go with. Happy to be here.
Okay. We'll dig right into that. So with that, I'd love to just understand a little bit about your upbringing and tell us a story about your journey.
I started out in a suburb of Boston. I had a chance to go to MIT as an undergraduate. I'm teaching here at Yale, but I didn't get into Yale. So it's my one differentiation from all of my students, where I discovered that although I thought I might be a potential mathematician, what it meant to be a real math guy was not something I had. And figured, what else could I do with those quantitative skills, and learned about economics. I was incredibly fortunate to have five courses with Robert Solow, a Nobel Prize winner. That was a time when MIT's economics department was the world's best for graduate students, but nobody took courses as an undergraduate in economics there. It was sparsely populated. In fact, this is one of my suggestions for people when they pick a college. Find a school where they do something incredibly well, but not that many people take advantage of it.
What are some tips on how someone could go about doing that? I'm sure you have some ideas for students and such.
Well, for example, if you want to study classics at Harvard, you know, they're going to recruit you. They have a wonderful faculty and almost no students. In contrast, if you want to do American studies or sociology at Princeton, there's a ton of students and not necessarily as great a faculty representatively. But at Princeton, math, they have five kids a year who major in it, and it's also the world's best department.
That's super interesting. Academic blue ocean strategy. Maybe that's your next book.
Yeah. So another example would be architecture at MIT. Fantastic department. People go to MIT to study computer science, but actually their architecture department is world class.
That is a really, really good insight.
Life hack, great strategy. Yeah. I love that.
And then you have the association with that brand, so that's amazing.
Yeah. So I discovered economics that allowed me to go to Oxford on a Rhodes Scholarship, where I had just wonderful advisors. Jim Merlies, who won a Nobel Prize. So I couldn't have asked for better mentors. And after that, I had a chance to be at Harvard for 3 years, Princeton for four. So it looked like I was having trouble holding a job. But I've now been at Yale for 32 years.
Wow.
And what brought me here was really wanting to be more connected to the world. So I was in the economics department at Princeton, and that was great. I was publishing in the academic journals. But there was a question of what was the connection between the ideas and the reality. And what was wonderful about Yale School of Management is that it was very much integrated into Yale. At Harvard, the business school is on the other side of the river and might as well be in a different planet. Here, it's all part of Yale. And we care about academic ideas. If you'd like, we're hoping to be in many ways the Yale Law School of Management, where ideas make a difference.
I love that, Barry. One thing we say a lot to the guests here is just part of the whole Forward Obsessed ethos is that we say ideas are nothing without execution.
Mm-hmm.
I'd love to understand, you know, clearly you've got this incredible, you know, background in academia. I'd love to understand, like, how do you go from a background to academia to starting a company, Honest Tea, that gets bought
by Coke?
Are we
able to curse on this program?
Absolutely. So yeah, show up as you.
I thought the line was ideas like assholes. Everybody has one.
And they all stink.
And they all stink. most of them stink.
I don't know. I think all assholes smell.
turning the idea into action. But, you know, let me say, people have said, oh, I'd rather have a great team and a mediocre idea than a great idea and a mediocre team.
Horses and jockeys again, like Matt McCooey was saying on the podcast.
I'm not as convinced of that.
Say more about that.
That I think having an idea that really is thought out, works well. Our execution in Honest Tea was not as great as it could have been by far. And we were saved by the fact that it was a great idea.
Mm.
So to jump the gun a little bit, you know, one of the things that's great about being a professor is that you get first dibs on students. That is, you get to see who's an amazing kid, who's somebody you'd like to connect with for the rest of your life. And I've had the opportunity to work with many of our alums in as board members, as investors, as partners. And in particular, one wonderful student back in 1995 was Seth Goldman. I advised him on his business plan. It was the first Yale business plan competition. And he had this idea of taking diapers and turning them into a medical device by putting a urinary tract, a test for urinary tract infections, mm-hmm. test strip. Because for seniors, sometimes they're very unhappy and they don't quite know why. They may have some dementia, they can't explain it, and now we know why grandpa is unhappy. Turns a diaper into a medical device. It was a great idea. Won the business plan competition. And at the same time, he said, you know, even though there's funding for this, even though there's $25,000, whatever, I don't want to be the medical diaper guy. And went on to work at Calvert Fund. But we kept in touch. And one of the things we had talked about in the class is why are there all these different varieties of beverages ranging from lemon, lime, root beer, colas, uncolas, carbonated, uncarbonated, flat, different sizes, all these different dimensions, but no differentiation in terms of sweetness. You either have water, which is boring, diet, which would be dangerous with all those additives, or sodas and teas, which were so sweet they were effectively liquid candy. Why wasn't there a normal beverage out there? And I didn't have a good answer for that. And 5 years later, Seth calls me up and says, you know that idea you talked about? Has anything ever happened with that? And the answer was no, but now I'm ready. I had just come back from India, where I was writing a case study. And one of the case studies I worked on was Tata Tea. And it turns out that tea is one of the world's cheapest luxury goods. Here in the United States, we drink lots of really bad tea.
Mm-hmm.
But great tea costs a nickel a cup. And therefore, there's no excuse for us to drink bad tea. And I'm not a tea connoisseur, but I could tell the difference between good tea and bad tea. And so having been over there, I thought, you know, why can't we do for tea what Starbucks had done for coffee? Iced tea is one of the world's most popular beverages. And when people go in a restaurant, they don't put in 12 teaspoons of sugar, maybe in the South. But most places they don't. And so why can't we make a tea that tastes like tea? And that was the essence of Honest Tea.
Awesome. Very, very, very cool. I love the fact that just clearly from your background, strategy, innovation, just the insight there was just, you could tell, like, it sounds so obvious when you listen to it now, but like, clearly this was being missed for years. You know, all the biggest beverage companies in the world were not going after this. Why do you think that was the case?
Yeah. So a couple reasons. One is that when you do a taste test and you give people little cups, and typically in a taste test, people prefer the sweeter product. And so when we do our taste tests, we ask you to drink the whole damn bottle. And I want to know what you feel at the end, not after the first sip.
Mm.
The second is, say I told you that we lose taste tests to Snapple 80-20. All right? Most big companies would say, you know, that's bad. You know, we're not going to proceed. But how many people were competing for the 80? You had Fuse, Vitamin Water, Arizona, Nesty, you know, a dozen companies are going after the 80, and they left the 20 all alone.
Mm.
And so I'd rather have the 20 to myself than be one of 10 people competing for the 80.
Love that.
So I'm a big iced tea fan. I grew up, my grandmother was a German Jew in Flushing, and she used to make fresh brewed iced tea.
Yeah.
Every, it was like a thing I remember growing up. It was the only place you got fresh brewed iced tea. And in college, I came up with the idea. It was 1999, so you had already started Honest, but I didn't know what it was yet. And I had come up with the idea to launch Grandma's Iced Tea. Mm-hmm. That was the name. And I did a business plan in college, and I brought in the iced tea, and I did a taste test with everybody, and it got obliterated. Nobody liked it. And it was like something that was very
personal to you.
Personal to me. We loved it. My family loved it. The guests that come over for dinner for Rosh Hashanah or whatever, we would plow through this iced tea. And we didn't move forward. And it was a fresh, not very sweet iced tea. And then Honest Tea became the brand. I personally didn't like Nest Tea tastes like chemical to me.
Nasty.
Yeah, nasty. It's not tea, exactly. Snapple was too sweet, as you mentioned, and the diet was awful. Nasty as well. And it's exactly that reason. They said, don't proceed because the taste test did not work. And I didn't have the insight that you just mentioned. And now I love these sort of full circle moments that happen in this room.
Well, here's something else that you might enjoy. Somebody did launch a brand called Grandma's Tea and actually worked out pretty well. It wasn't a total failure. So it's not such a bad name at the end of the day. And let me say that this is another lesson of economics, which is what I'll call the declining marginal utility. The first pair of shoes you get prevents your feet from getting cut. Then you can have dress shoes, you could have sneakers, you could have flip-flops. But by the time you're Imelda Marcos, you know, the extra shoe after you've gone 50, whatever, 60 pairs, you can't wear them. Well, I think the same thing is true of sugar. The first teaspoon of sugar takes away the bitterness. The second adds some flavor. And that's where you should stop. You don't need to go to 12. So I think one of the issues you may have had with your grandma's iced tea was that maybe adding one or two teaspoons of sugar rather than zero would make it a little bit more popular. You don't have to go. People think about going to extremes. Zero or 120 calories. Zero teaspoons or 12. One or two is, I think, still okay.
I love that you said that. I'm a big believer that everything in the world lives on a gradient, right? Mm-hmm. There's no sort of one edge to the other. It's just sort of that gradation of change. And we see that in innovation all the time, right? It's just sort of dialing in that right mix is super key. Sorry, you were going to say something?
No.
Everything in moderation, including moderation.
Absolutely.
And one of the things that had stopped me originally was I was fixated on the idea of mixing orange juice and club soda. I don't know if any of you do that. Grape juice and club soda, cranberry juice and club soda.
I mean, I do
mix cranberry juice and club soda for sure. Yeah.
Vodka and club soda.
Yeah. Okay. Well, the problem, my view of that is it's a great product, but it'd be too easy for Tropicana to copy. Mm-hmm. And my goal in life was not to be a test market for Tropicana. Hmm. Now, at the end of the day, actually, Spindrift has done it and done it really well.
Yeah, with the real fruit and all that.
And I think they've shown that there is this idea of the highly diluted fruit juice. In fact, another company that's doing it even better, in my view, is Ruby, where they put hibiscus and Concord grape juice together, 30 calories, huge amount of flavor, carbonation. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, I feel like we're going to need to nerd out on the beverage category because me and our firm, Digital Surgeons, has done a lot in the beverage category. Unfortunately, never worked with Honest, but that's a bummer. But speaking of which, so I discovered recently that Coke discontinued Honest Tea. So before you tell us the reason why, because I don't know why, I'd love to understand what that meteoric rise was. Because, you know, going from, you know, when Seth comes back to you with this idea a couple of years later, you're just getting back from India. You had mentioned it was a great idea, but you had mentioned earlier mediocre execution. So how did mediocre execution get you to a pretty amazing exit?
Well, we succeeded in spite of ourselves. I mean, at one point we had glass bottles that broke and we had glass, and then we had to do a national recall. We had inconsistent flavors, but the idea was so strong. Customers were so loyal to us that they gave us second and third chances.
Wow.
It'd be better if we didn't have to have taken them because at one time we lost a whole summer of sales because we spent our whole effort taking products off the shelves, not putting it on the shelves. We launched Honest Kombucha, and in the end, the product turned alcoholic. And we ended up having $1 million of lawsuits because we were tricking people into drinking alcohol. We had to take it off the shelves because it violated the 0.5%. Rule that is required for non-alcoholic products.
Is that just based on the fermentation? It just took its own effect?
So Kombucha is alive, and it's a symbiotic culture of bacteria and yeast. And that what that yeast does is they keep on eating sugar and turning it into alcohol. That's what they do. And so it was totally legal when it left the plant, but sometimes maybe it wasn't properly refrigerated, or maybe it was on the shelf too long. And so it went from 0.4% to 0.7%. So again, that was another issue that we had to face.
Something tells me there's an insight in that later that I'm sure we'll follow back up on.
Well, it's actually, so it's, it, that's the reason why a lot of companies like Whole Foods that won't put more CBD products on their shelf, because CBD over time turns into THC. So the same aging process is happening in the, in those products.
Interesting.
Yeah, and it's not the legality when you make it. It's the legality when it's sold. Yeah. So those were always challenges for us. But customers who liked us had a passion. One of the, my other mottos in life is you can't have lovers if you also don't have haters. Mm. So don't go middle of the road. And, you know, there were people who, when they tried Honest Tea, it's just like, oh, this tastes like warm piss. To which my response was, you have to try it refrigerated. But if you were a Snapple drinker, we weren't trying to convert you. We wanted to find all those people who couldn't find stuff they wanted to drink. And over the years, we started off, we were way too early. We were really before the organic movement. So we could mess around in the hinterlands for 3 years, figuring out how to make it better, how to get rid of some of the sediment, how to get our costs to a reasonable level, so that by the time the Whole Foods revolution really happened, we were well positioned to take advantage of it.
I love that you said position, because one of my curiosities was, from in the early days, what was the brand positioning and who were you essentially, like, what was the behavior shift you were getting, like, from a communications perspective? I stopped drinking X and I go to Honest. I stopped drinking Y, I go to Honest. What was the positioning?
I can't find what it is I want to drink. And so I come to you. And
so the experience seeker came to you essentially.
It's the people who the market had ignored. I mean, the emails we would get are, where have you been my whole life? Finally, somebody listens to me. And that's the message we had in the back of our label in terms of we look for tea that tastes like tea, but couldn't find any. So we made our own, just like your grandmother. Basically, we're going to save her some effort. We didn't have one huge misunderstanding in our business, which is when we began, we thought the most important word in our name was tea. And so the first product line extension we did was tea bags, which really failed. And they failed for lots of reasons, including execution. We had bags that did not hold their... we wanted to put whole leaf tea in a tea bag. And so ultimately we found a condom maker, because they need to put big stuff in little pouches. And that didn't work out so well. But, of course, what's the most important word in our name?
Honest.
Honest. And that led us to realize, what other products could we make honest? And the product that came next was Honest Kids. And we said, okay, the Capri Sun juice pouch, you know, that got 120 calories, same, 110 actually, same as kind of a soda, actually more in the sense that they were 6.75 ounces.
Right.
And so could we make a product that parents would be proud to serve to their kids? And we cut the calories by 2/3. We made it organic, got rid of the high fructose corn syrup. And that product has exploded. It still exists. Coke has not gotten rid of Honest Kids. It's there in Happy Meals and McDonald's. It's really taken off.
Fantastic.
So before we go back to the question about Coke discontinuing Honest Tea, it sounds like you had quite a difficult time initially, but you had good customers. Who was it, or where was the stick-to-itiveness to stick it out and to continue to see this through until the Whole Foods revolution? Because most people would throw the cards in and say, we don't know what we're doing.
Yeah. We were getting awesome feedback. And so we just knew that if we could stop tripping over ourselves, we would be there. And we put our emails on the labels. We were one of the first people to really tell our story on the packaging. That's a mistake I think a lot of companies make, is they spend their efforts patting themselves on the back, saying how great, delicious they are. I don't want to hear that. I want to understand why it is I should like the product. So
what's in it for me?
Yeah. Well, what is the experience going to be? Is it going to be a strong taste, a subtle taste? So how to prepare yourself for the experience, how to communicate to others why they should be happy to try this product as well.
Yeah, I always appreciated your branding from the early days. I'm obviously a branding nerd, so yeah.
Which leads me to my next question. The name, so you figured out that Honest was more important than tea, but where did Honest come from?
When I was in India, I had a chance to meet the folks at Tata Tea, and they wanted to export their teas from companies other than Kyrgyzstan and other stands to Germany, the United States, and the like. And they were wondering how to do it. And okay, here was their business school professor. So they asked me, and I thought about it. And those days, remember, 1998, people hadn't heard of Tata. Now we know about Tata Engineering, Tata Consulting,
Tata Nano, Jaguar Land Rover,
JLR. But in those days,
relatively obscure.
Outside of India. But what did Tata stand for? Integrity, reliability, trustworthiness. So I proposed that they sell their tea under the name Honest Tea. And the proposal fell on deaf ears, because I proposed it to Ratan Tata, who said, oh, no, I prefer the Tata name. At which point I said, okay, great, I'll keep it then. And so I had the name Honest Tea.
The only ego that consumers care about is their own. So I guess in this case, you're a win.
Yes. I offered it to them, and they gave it right back to me.
So that turned out to be a gift, because that Honest name ultimately led people to lean in on the brand and ask questions.
Yeah, and
create a curiosity.
And let's be clear, you know, we didn't take it as far as it could have. So Jessica Alba,
I was going to say,
has created the Honest company, right, with diapers and sunscreens and the like. So we were smart enough to think of Honest Kids, Honest Foods, and so on. But the Honest potential was even bigger than we had imagined.
Mm. So I had read that you sold the company to Coca-Cola, which we'll start to get into now. One of the reasons why is because you had leveraged, you guys had leveraged your homes and your lives. Is this accurate? Or I'd imagine you didn't. You had a full-time job still, correct?
Oh, no. I mean, we had a $5 million line of credit that Seth and I had personally guaranteed.
Got it.
And so if stuff went wrong, you know, that was, you know, houses, life savings, everything. And we were both equally responsible for the whole thing. So that was kind of a bit scary.
Yeah.
One of the lessons that I've learned from this is to help companies that I'm involved with have their entrepreneurs be able to take some money off the table. Because essentially we might have continued running this business if we could have somehow figured out a way to get our names off the loan, to take $1 million out, so that maybe that, you know, could pay for a private school or a new car or a vacation or whatever else.
A break.
Actually, so one thing that is worth focusing on is, you know, after the sale to Coke, I could do anything I wanted with the rest of my life. Seth could do the same thing. And both of us ended up living in the same houses, married to the same women, and by which I mean he's married to his wife, I'm married to Helen. Same house, same wife, same job. And so one of the things I say to people is, think about if you had unlimited resources, unconstrained resources, you know, would you keep on doing what you are doing? And if that's true, you're doing the right thing. And the changes I did make involve things like cleaning up my office, which took 3 years, and hiring
somebody. We have something in common.
I'm sorry?
We have something in common. You should see my office. Dave gets mad at me for it all the time.
And hiring a personal trainer. Both of which I could have done beforehand.
Sure.
And so, again, think about what things you would do and why aren't you doing them today?
Mm-hmm. Mm. And then you stayed in CPG because you would. So you had the. So before we move into staying into CPG, what was it like to sell to Coca-Cola? The idea of the exit. You wrote a book on negotiation that just came out, correct?
Right. Split the pie.
How was that? Did you split the pie with Coca-Cola?
We did. In fact, that was the first time the theory of split the pie left the classroom and came into the world.
I want to ask you about that. And of course, for the audience, because I know the question's in your mind right now, all of these links are going to be in the show notes. So definitely check out those show notes for a link to the book. So one of the more famous books on negotiation is by Chris Ross, the Hotchkiss negotiator, Never Split the Difference.
Yeah, Chris Voss.
Right, Chris Voss, yes. Tell me about how your theory on split the pie differs and contrasts on that. Just yeah. love to understand so, that. Because you know a thing or two about game theory. I mean,
I do. Look, I'm with Voss on splitting the difference makes no sense. If you make one arbitrary claim and I make another arbitrary claim, halfway between two crazy ideas is still crazy. Alternatively, if I make a principled argument and you make an unprincipled argument, meeting in the middle is not principled. So don't split the difference. Makes perfect sense to me. That doesn't tell you what you should do. It tells you what you shouldn't do. And so my view is you should understand what it is you're negotiating over, the value that's created by that negotiation, and split it. So let's go to the Coke Honest Tea example. We all agreed that Coke would buy Honest Tea in 3 years, that we were a little too small to fit into the organization, that it would be better for us to get our revenue up, and that during those 3 years, they would help us with production, with distribution, with purchasing. But can you see what the problem is with them helping us for 3 years and then buying us?
They could slow down your earnout. They could give you. They could reduce your resources.
Yeah, but they want to do all those things. They want to help us. They want to make us bigger, better. What don't they want to do if they're helping us in all these ways?
They don't want to compete with you?
Well, no, we're not really in a different space. They don't want to pay more for all the stuff they're doing to help us. So it's like, okay, we can get you from X to Y, but why should we? We don't want to pay for all the stuff that we're doing to help. And my response is, well, you shouldn't pay full price for that. We should pay half price. Because it's true we need you to help us, but you also need us to be the vehicle to help. And so essentially you need our customers, our product, our brand to apply to your purchasing. Mm-hmm. You've already applied your purchasing power to all the stuff you're making. If you want to apply it to us, you need our customers. And so what you should do is pay full price on sales we achieve up to X and half price on sales we achieve above X. We couldn't get above X without you, but there would be no us to get above X without us.
Yeah, a very fair, very fair.
And so the pie that we're creating is the sales above X. We could have done X without you. And we agreed on that framework in the first hour. Now, there was a discussion of what's X, what can we achieve without you? And there's a discussion of what's a fair price that we can then take and divide into. But I'd say those are really much more data questions than they are negotiation issues. And so we agreed, let's create a giant pie and split it. And then our focus can be on how do we make the pie big?
Love that.
And it was that easy? Everybody talks about the exits are so hostile and stressed out, stressing and all this other stuff. That was it. It sounds like it was pretty fair and reasonable.
I think so. People, you know, say, oh, you really want to negotiate with Barry Nailboff, the expert on the, and it's like, yeah, actually you do, because I got a framework. My view is I want to go and create a big pie and split it. We can't both get more than half the pie. And if we both try to, then in the end, we both end up with zero. People think negotiation can be a zero-sum game because the more I get, the less you get. Other folks say, oh no, we can work together to make the pie bigger. Sure. But even if we can't make the pie bigger, reaching an agreement gets us away from the zero-zero outcome and therefore actually is win for both of us.
I like that. One of our mentors actually, John, I was raised in a family. My father always believed that negotiation was a I win, you lose, right? You want $100,000 for your house, I'm going to offer you 50 and insult you and see if I can do that 1,000 times to 1,000 different people and eventually hit for a win where you lose and I win. And so I took that mentality into a lot of the conversations and negotiations that I had in business with Pete or on behalf of our business or otherwise.
I always took the bad deals though.
Until one guy said to me, never make an offer, never offer a deal that you wouldn't take yourself.
Yeah.
And he said, I don't have to lose for you to win. We should both win. Yeah. So I really like that. I like that idea. And I try to diffuse those scenarios where people believe that they have to be hostile in a negotiation. And aggressive.
And one way to avoid that hostility and aggression is to agree up front on how you're going to negotiate. So don't start with a price. Start with a process. Can we agree that our goal is to create a big pie and split it? and if you can get that agreement, life is going to be easy. So let me give you an example from my mom. She was living as a renter in Sarasota, and that became a hot market with work from home. And her landlord said, I'm going to put the house in the market. I think the market price is $800K, but since you're living there, I like you, I'll sell it to you for $790. Okay. So what is this negotiation really about? That's a question. I'm a professor. I get to ask questions. What's the value created by the two of them doing a deal?
He's looking to extract some liquidity from that event. Then
yeah, so B's going to, but he can get that by selling to somebody else. Why does he want to sell to her?
It's easy.
It's easy in particular.
Yeah. Less time, no broker fee.
No, 5% broker fee is $40K.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He doesn't have to fix up the place. Yeah. She doesn't have to move and spend moving costs.
Yeah.
I claim that's what the negotiation is really about.
Yep.
And so she comes back and says, look, I'm happy to pay market price, but doing this deal with you will save $40,000 in real estate agent fees. You'll save, I don't know, $10K fixing it up. I'll save $10K for moving.
Move and all that. Yeah, sure.
So let's call that a wash. So let's split the $40K 20-20. And if you'll take the market price minus 20, we'll both be 20 ahead.
Mm.
And he comes back and says, Marcia, I don't think you understand. It's a hot market. So that's why I should get more of the 40. And the response to that is no. The hot market is why the market price is high. But if you sell to anybody else at 800, you get 760. And if I buy the equivalent house from anybody else, I have to pay 800. So the only way we get that 40K savings is if the two of us do a deal together. And that's why we should get 20-20. And he agrees. And then he actually gets religion and says, you know, why don't we use the same lawyer? And that way we don't each have to pay $2,500. We can save another $2,500 and split that too, which they did.
Fantastic. Is that story in the book?
That story is not in the book because it happened after the book came out.
I just had this happen yesterday. So yeah. I made an offer for a building, a retail building that I'm really excited about for new business. And it wasn't on the market. I was introduced to the broker that just took the listing. The owner wanted $2.1 million. And I ran 100 calculations to determine what the value of the property was. I landed at 1.8 was a rich deal. But I realized that he had purchased the building in 2019 for 1.8 million. And it had a AAA lease in it. But the lease ended because of some issues. So now I can't get past 1.8. I said, this is impossible. But I really, really want the location. The location is so important to me. And he... his response to my offer at 1.8 was, yeah, nice try. That's what he said to the broker. And then I iced him for 3 days and didn't respond because it wasn't listed. And then I realized that he was trying to squeeze the broker out of the deal because he didn't want to pay the 5% to the broker. So the only thing I could come up with to get him to move and to act, which hasn't happened yet because I offered the deal yesterday, was I offered to pay the broker. Because if it was the broker fee that was holding him up from the deal, from even negotiating, even countering, because the difference from 2.1 to 1.8 is only 300,000. We're not that far off. Clearly had to be something was sticking with him. I think it's the broker fee. So we'll find out in the next 24 hours. How would you have approached that differently?
Well, so that's what else does this person care about? Do they care about closing quickly? Do they care about closing slowly?
It's hard to know if he doesn't. I gave him my reasoning for my offer.
But that's a different point from asking the questions.
Yeah.
Which is, what is it you want?
Oh, I was trying to get answers. I got a nice try.
Well, you started with money.
Yeah.
As opposed to, at some point, we're going to talk about money. But what else matters to you?
Yeah.
Like I said, you want to close quickly?
That's what he said. Quickly, cash deal would be ideal.
And then you can say to the broker, look, are you handling both sides of this transaction? Normally, you don't get to do that.
Yeah.
And so...
Which he is.
And so, therefore, normally you get 2.5% if you're only handling one side. Now, you know, would you take 3 if you handle both? And so that's another 2%. That's $40,000. That helps.
So what I did was I said, I told the broker, I'll protect you and I'll pay your fee, but you have to reduce it for me. So I negotiated with the broker instead of the
landlord. That's fine, but that's the same thing in the end. Basically, you're reducing it to 3%.
Yeah.
And in the end, I don't think it really matters who pays it, long as the broker in this particular deal it's coming down to 3%. Is there something, does this person want to keep an office there? Do they want, I don't know if they're using any of the real estate themselves.
Yeah.
Do they care about protecting any of their current renters in some way?
Yeah, there's nothing. It's
or not, so.
Yeah, I think that's about it. That's why I was trying to think through it, but I think we.
Do they want any share of the appreciation? Do they want to keep any equity in this deal? I don't know.
So it sounds like, folks, if you don't know what the pie is that you're negotiating for, you definitely need to read Barry's new book.
Get the book, A Radical New Way to Negotiate.
Can't wait to read that.
Yeah, indeed.
So now this.
Coca-Cola discontinued, sorry.
So the transaction happens with Coca-Cola.
Yep, that's and 2011.
And Coca-Cola maintained the Dynasty brand for a number of years, right?
Yeah, basically a dozen years.
Yeah, a dozen years. And then after a dozen years, and again, I wasn't following that brand very closely.
Oh, come on.
After the transaction,
I always drink Honesty.
There you go.
Every single time.
And you know, you are looking so good. I got to say.
Thank you.
Yeah, I drink way too much coffee. That's my problem. I should probably get on some Honesty before they kill it. But well, there might be some better stuff there on the table, literally, right? What's on the table today? So I think with that, then they've recently decided to discontinue it. Can you talk specifically about the why behind that, or well, what's been out there?
They didn't really discuss it with us. They just announced it in the press, and that's sort of how we learned about an hour or two before it became public.
Okay.
So we can speculate. I mean, one of the challenges they had was Honesty was in a proprietary bottle, which was hard to get during the pandemic.
Okay. So supply chain challenges.
All right. Switch over to the generic bottle for a while. Our customers would understand that. Another was the margins on Honest Tea weren't as good as the margins on Peace Tea and on Gold Peak.
Okay.
All right. Well, you know, what's the future of this world? Is the world going to be drinking dirty brown sugar water? Or is it going to be drinking products that are important for your health? And so do you have a bridge to that future or not?
Hmm.
In the end, you know, there was one person who was in charge of all their tea portfolios and decided that Fuze and Honest weren't going to make it. Peace Tea and Gold Peak were the future. They're consolidating the number of brands. They kept, as I said, Honest Kids.
Mm-hmm.
There you go. And as Seth's said, it was a gut punch. This is our baby. We did this to change the world by offering people healthier alternatives. Moreover, we'd become one of the largest purchasers of fair trade tea in the world. And suddenly they have the brand stop, left all those farmers high and dry. These people who had converted to organic, converted to fair trade. And now what were they going to do with all this tea they were growing?
Hmm.
So we felt we couldn't abandon them.
Yeah, it's almost like you had to give them some justice, right?
And we also didn't want to leave our customers high and dry.
Hmm.
And so Seth and I got the band back together, and we decided we would create a new tea to fill in the gap that was now there. We weren't going to ever go back in that space and compete against Coke, but if they're going to empty the shelf, all right, can we take advantage of that?
So I see here on the table we've got just iced tea, and the branding mind to me says there's a bit of a double entendre with justice tea. So I'd love to hear just a little bit more about your thinking on that.
So the question is, what motivated us? And it was justice to our farmers, to our fair trade suppliers who had essentially grown with us, invested with us, and we wanted to give them the justice that they deserved. And that's what motivated this product. So it is, should we say, a kissing cousin to many of the flavors that you would have known and loved at Honest. It's got a green tea with mint, Moroccan mint, berry hibiscus, a peach oolong, a half and half, lemonade, and
my favorite
iced tea, an unsweetened green tea, and I've probably forgotten one. Oh, a honey green tea.
Mm-hmm.
It's all in glass. Glass is really the most recyclable, best tasting vehicle. And what's remarkable is I don't think anybody in the history of consumer products has gone from idea to on the shelf in 12 weeks.
Wow. That's how long it took, 12 weeks.
So we are now for sale in Whole Foods and some Sprouts, still rolling out, so it's inconsistent. But we had buyers at Whole Foods and Sprouts take this sight untasted.
Wow.
Because they understood what the product is. They trusted the team. And
do over time.
So it was and just getting organic certification, fair trade certification, kosher certification, getting labels printed, labels designed. You know, all of that in 12 weeks was insane.
Wow. So how do you pull that off while also teaching at one of the most prestigious universities in the world?
I'm on the board. Not an operator, thank goodness, for the company, because that's not my strength. So the good news is there was a company called Eat the Change, which Seth had founded with Spike Mendelsohn, a wonderful celebrity chef. And they were working on snacks, making carrots, chews rather than raisins. They were making mushroom jerky rather than beef jerky. So essentially creating a fantastic set of healthy snacks. And we had a sales team that was ready, up to go. We had production. And in fact, Justice Tea is being made at some of the same plants that Honest Tea was being made at. So we had folks who knew how to make it, a sales team that was ready to go, many of whom were veterans from the Honest Tea days.
So you won't break glass again.
So plug and play.
We sounds like a song. We won't break glass it does again.
Love
who,
it.
Right?
Yeah, no, absolutely. No, I mean, I think that gets me thinking about, I remember when I had the pleasure of having lunch with you a number of years ago, and you know, you gave me a signed copy of your book, Why Not? Mm-hmm. And you know, I had read, you know, all the design thinking sort of, you know, greatest hits, right? You know, books like Creative Confidence by the IDEO brothers and the 10 Types of Innovation and all the other fancy books. And everybody always talks about what if, and I had never seen somebody ask the question of why not. I'd love to understand more about like what motivated you to write that book. And then I've got a follow-up for you on two of my favorite sort of games that you reference in the book that I know we use a lot in our design thinking processes here at Digital Surgeons. So why write the book, Why Not?
I was at my good friend Ian Ayres' 40th birthday party. And he's my co-author in Why Not. Mm-hmm. And people were roasting him at that birthday party with what was Ian's stupidest idea. And can you think he bought of that idea? Oh my God, now I got a better one. And as each idea came up, I was thinking, you know, I kind of like that idea. Gee, I wish I had thought of that. These aren't so stupid. And so initially we started writing a column at Forbes magazine where we were talking about ideas that we think should happen. And the book, the original idea for the book was going to be a list of ideas that the world needed. But over time, we realized that better than a list was a set of techniques to help people come up with their own ideas for making the world a better place.
Such as some thinking frameworks, if you will.
Exactly. And McKinsey talks about something called MECE, mutually exclusive, collectively exhaustive. Our lists are not mutually exclusive. They're not collectively exhaustive. But we think they really work. And they're things that have helped us in our research, in our practice. And so... let us share them.
Yeah. Two of my favorite ones that I literally use every day, but I'm going to make you explain them because as a professor, you can probably articulate it a whole lot better than I can, was symmetry and arbitrage. Mm-hmm. So I'd love it if you could just, I've introduced the concept of arbitrage to so many first-time sure. founders and entrepreneurs, because if you don't go to B school and you don't learn some of the fancy terms, a word like arbitrage can sort of sound like a fancy French food sometimes. So could you maybe talk to the group?
Would you like some arbitrage with with the chips?
That's a good exactly. accent.
S'il vous plaît. Yes, I'd like my arbitrage poached.
It does have a little French vibe to it, right? Yeah. So what are
especially
the...
Especially when Barry
does it. Yeah, it's way better. Tell the audience a little bit about In the Why Not book, which is a great book. You folks should definitely check it out. It's a couple years old, but I think there's so many evergreen concepts now in there that still hold true today. But talk to me about just what is the game of arbitrage in the context of your book.
Yeah. Take an idea that exists in one concept, in one context, and ask where else it could apply. So if it's been successful in this space, could you use it somewhere else? And You know, an example of that might be, in some sense, pay per use. So when I go and buy Kleenex, I pay per box of Kleenex. But if you think about it, if you're an OBGYN doc and you're buying insurance against malpractice, for some reason, the insurance price that you buy doesn't depend on how many babies you deliver. And what that means is that docs can't work half time. Because if they work half time, they still have to pay the full price of malpractice, and that's insane. It doesn't make the business work. But the risk is based on how many kids you deliver, not on calendar time. And so can we correct the pricing, if you'd like? We already know how to do this pricing on a per unit basis. Can we fix it by taking ideas that worked in one context and really make sense? Applying it somewhere else.
Math's coming back for you. Saying you, in the early part of the conversation, you said math was not the thing, but I heard that some actuaries would be pretty excited by that pretty model right there.
Yeah, and we see that happening in some other contexts now. People are moving to pay-per-mile insurance for cars.
Yeah.
And again, it doesn't make sense to charge the same price for auto insurance if you drive 10,000 miles or 100,000 miles.
Yeah.
We charge per mile basically when you buy gasoline. We don't say, hey, you can have all you can drive gas. But we do have all-you-can-drive insurance. So essentially, this pay-per-use idea can be taken from one context and brought into other places.
Or even pay-for-performance in the same sense, sure. Right? Because the insurance companies are putting that little marker in your car so that they can monitor how you drive.
Absolutely.
To determine the speeds you drive and how you're braking and all that. And then yeah. They can make a price based off of your performance.
Yeah, based on the better estimate of your risk.
Yeah.
Risk.
Well, it's interesting because one of my favorite quotes ever is from the designer Charles Ames, and I have a print literally in my office that says eventually everything connects, right? Mm-hmm. And much like this new concept in your book, you know, Split the Pie, really essentially the relationship between insurance company and the insured and that whole relationship, there's an arbitrage play there, but we're seeing it a lot with everything. So, you know, you folks are probably listening to this and saying, oh, well, I see that in social media. There's certain ways that people are working with influencers now on one platform or in one way that really mirrors a lot of things that we've been doing for 20, 30 years. Second game in the book is the game of symmetry.
Yeah.
And I'm curious because I'm a huge Charlie Munger fan. If you guys don't know, Charlie Munger is sort of Warren Buffett's right-hand man. So obviously Warren Buffett, really successful investor. And he sort of introduced that mental model of inversion, mm-hmm. right? And I use that technique a lot. But inversion's pretty different than your concept of symmetry, but there's similarities.
I don't know. I mean, maybe it's the same. So I'll do an example with you. I don't think it's in the book. Take Lay's potato chips and their slogan for many years, bet you can't eat just one. Flip that slogan for me. Bet you
can
eat just one.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right?
Sure.
That's good. So now you have to market a potato chip with a slogan, bet you can eat just one. And the idea of the flip is it's going to force me to think about something in a new way. So why would I want to do a potato chip where bet you can eat just one is the motto? Okay, well, it's super spicy.
I was going to say hot peppers. That's what I have.
It's gigantic. All right. Now I'm going to make your life a little harder. You have to sell the exact same potato chip you're selling today under the motto, bet you can eat just one. Why would that be a good thing?
So for me, where my mind goes is you're shifting the construct of consumption.
Mm-hmm.
So
exactly. Is it a good thing that you're eating only one?
Well, a million reasons.
Well, there's one big reason why.
Serving size.
But what's the good reason? Why was the customer going to be happy to answer the question, bet you can eat just one? And to live that life.
I mean, for me, I'm looking at it through like the marketing messaging of like, I'm more healthy by
exactly.
that. Exactly.
Potato chips aren't healthy.
Right.
So the reason I don't like potato chips is I'm going to eat too damn many of them.
It's kind of like those Justin's little
exactly.
chocolate
so
cups.
So guess what? What has Justin said to you? Bet you can eat just one.
Yep.
It's the portion controlled package.
Absolutely.
And they can charge a premium for selling you fewer chips.
Yeah.
It's almost the individually wrapped potato chip.
So what I love about this, and this is for the folks listening, is where I think symmetry is different from Charlie Munger's inversion is Charlie Munger uses the construct of saying, okay, what are all the things that would have to happen or not have to happen to achieve this thing? Mm-hmm. So he uses it more of a mental model for like strategic goal planning.
Okay.
Versus what I'm hearing is I can see a construct like symmetry, which you talk about in your book, Why Not, being used as a really strong ideation device.
Exactly.
For divergent thinking and yes. really fostering that. Versus like inversion's more about negation and mm-hmm. and sort of, I would argue risk mitigation, but so I do think that they're different, but arguably you're just taking a construct of flipping something on its head, which I think is really provocative.
Yeah. So life insurance, the flip of that, death insurance. Now, in fact, life insurance is really death insurance because it's insuring you against death. So what would actually be insuring you against life? It actually is you're going to live too long. So I really need insurance to protect me against excess longevity.
For me, what I think is interesting as a marketer is in that construct, right? And obviously, you served on the board of Nationwide for some time, so you know a thing or two about insurance, probably a lot more than I do. But the thing that shows up for me is a lot of times playing off the construct of scarcity mm-hmm. is something that I think is really interesting. So it's like if you were to almost guilt me, like I use the ocean model a lot in personality, like neuroticism. Mm-hmm. If you went after people that have a high amount of neuroticism, getting them to think and worry about their family mm-hmm. and then leaving their family high and dry, mm-hmm. that would definitely motivate me from signing on to a life insurance thing faster than saying, or death insurance, excuse me, faster than saying, hey, sign up for this life insurance policy. I'm like, oh, I don't need that yet. I'm super healthy. But mm-hmm. that sort of symmetry concept of flipping it could be
the
helpful.
Allocentric versus egocentric. Ego is self, allo is others. And in negotiation, in strategy, in good marriage, it's all about being allo rather than egocentric.
So Barry, you got a certain disposition about you that I find endearing. You've got lots of success. You talk about some of the pitfalls, couple of national recalls, some accidental
alcohol
in Honest Kombucha, which I would say is probably a pretty big pitfall that you then turned around. What's been the biggest pitfall in your life, in your business life?
You know, I've had companies that didn't make it. I invested many years and lots of money in a business to do title insurance. I think title insurance is close to a scam. When this business, we ran it for 5 years, how many claims do you think we had?
None.
Zero. If you underwrite the title insurance correctly, then there's nothing to claim. And people are forced to pay a huge amount of money for this product that they don't want and they don't need. And other countries like France, there is no title insurance. It's just a central title agency, title records mm-hmm. place. And so when I see an industry that's really messed up and it's not helping customers, is there an ability to fix it? And in the end, either we couldn't break through the lawyers, the folks, oh, you're spending $500,000 on a house. You know, don't you want the best title insurance? It's only 11,000 versus 6,000 and, you know, oh, 5,000, it's only 1%. Who cares? It's all part of, I'm putting the mortgage. And so we had trouble getting people to pay attention. We had trouble connecting with the customers directly because they're not thinking about this. And the lawyers in many places get 50% of the premium. And so there's just giant kickbacks that we had to deal with.
And how did that feel? What was that like? To lose.
Terrible. I mean, you hate it when your friends, your investors lose money. It's no fun losing money. It's also sucks because now you're stuck buying title insurance from other people who you really dislike.
Do you look at yourself as the customer when you do these decisions, when you make these decisions, like you're trying to solve problems that you have and that you dislike, or are you like, where is the obsession? Where's the line? Is it egocentric or allocentric when you're making these decisions? Because the tea was a you thing. You like tea.
It wasn't actually, we talked about the alcohol kombucha. I love kombucha.
Mm-hmm.
And ultimately that led to a company where we turned lemons into lemonade.
We started
kombucha, which was a slightly alcoholic kombucha.
Yeah.
Because one of my problems is I go to a party and everyone's drinking beer or wine, and I want to participate in that alcohol, but not to the point where I get drunk.
We got to get you some THC beverages.
Yeah. So the motto we had was get tickled, not pickled.
Yeah.
I want to be able to go back to work afterwards or to work out, to be able to drive. And so why wasn't there, just like sugar, you know, you could have a low sugar. Why can't you have a low alcohol, alcoholic product, a 1%, a 2%, rather than a 5% product? And so that was the idea there.
And Anheuser-Busch bought that?
AB InBev.
AB InBev.
Bought that. Yep.
What happened to that brand since?
They didn't really believe in the 1% or 2%. They raised the alcohol level up to 4 or 5. And I'd say they had trouble really rolling it out in ways that you wouldn't think they'd have trouble rolling it out. So we were pretty much the first alcoholic kombucha out there. And now it's been eclipsed by Juneshine and many others. And so it's, I think, a missed opportunity. It's sad.
Yeah. They didn't believe in the no alcohol, non-alcoholic either. And then all of a sudden, now everybody's doing it. Heineken's in the game. Budweiser Zero's in the, Bud Zero's in the game. Yeah, after they saw what Athletic Brewing did. It's funny that you mentioned in the on the beverage side. I don't know if you pay attention to any of the THC stuff that's happening. So THC beverages have been around for a really long time in California and, you know, West Coast, Colorado, and so on.
You're not talking about CBD. You're talking about THC.
THC. Yeah. But most of the brands were doing 10, 20, 50, 100 milligram beverages, which is very, very strong. And then a couple of guys started going after the low-dose market and 2-3 milligrams of THC, so it's more of a social consumable, and they're taking off. I mean, you've got Can, which is over $100 million in value in multiple states. Levia,
so it's
out
the
of
same idea that I was having in terms of the get tickled, not pickled. What's the aversion of less high?
Yeah,
get elevated, not high.
Right. Exactly. And the other thing is that it's taking away from the alcohol market now, because people around, I've seen it quite a bit. We're involved, me more than Pete, in the cannabis space now. And we're paying very close attention to the edible and the beverage space. And there is a large faction of people that no longer want to drink alcohol, want some type of social fun, and they're going after a low dose.
Right. It's no fun being at the party and saying, oh, can I have the cranberry juice and club soda, please? Can I have the Shirley Temple? You know,
you're not
engaged. It's like I'm an outsider.
Yeah.
And a wine spritzer is just not cool. So in terms of alcoholic kombucha, you know, if I'm eating healthy and everything else I do, why do I suddenly give that up when I'm going to the social party?
Yeah.
No, I love that. I want to be respectful of your time. I know you're a really, really busy guy, and I'm just watching the clock here. So I think this is a good place for us to start to come to a close. The big question is lightning round. So would love to just fire off a few questions in terms of like what the future looks like for you. So I know you're serving on a number of boards right now, obviously still very active with Yale. But for those that are listening to this, you know, if there are Seths out there that are not Seth, you know, you've got, from what I can see and what the audience will certainly see, a very, very unique mind and very strategic. Talk to us about like what's next for you.
Well, I've got a lot of things happening right now. There's a startup called Real Made Foods, which is making overnight oats or helping people to make their own overnight oats. So you can check that out. Banana coffee is my favorite flavor. It's a little unusual. It's got its lovers and its haters. There's mulberry chia is another option that's a little more mainstream, and apple coconut. Of course, we just launched Just Iced Tea, and that's exciting. And the new book with Split the Pie. And so how can we help change the way people negotiate? Because most people negotiate poorly. One of my stories I say is I love my students. They're empathetic. They're smart. They're wonderful until they negotiate. And then, just like you, a lot of them feel like they have to act like somebody they aren't and throw away all the skills that make them successful when they try and basically bully, be aggressive, take a zero-sum mindset, and so on. And so if we can change the way people negotiate in society, boy, would that be a wonderful change.
Love that. Now, there's so many more things I wish we had time to cover, so we'll definitely have to have you back.
Do you have a goal? You got 32 years in Yale?
Yeah.
Do you have a goal? Do you have a, like a, in your mind, do you have a date that says, okay, I'm going to hang
it up? I got the corner office now, so that's good. you know, one of the things about being a professor is there's no mandatory retirement. I got tenure. But there's also, you want to make room for the next generation. And so I would say we have a social norm, a social custom of retiring in your early 70s.
Okay.
And I think that kind of makes sense. That doesn't mean that you stop teaching, you stop doing research, you can be a gig worker, you can go and, you know, maybe I'll teach at UCLA one quarter a year out when it's warm, go and kind of do some visiting gigs. The nice thing is that, you know, the students keep you young, and you're constantly getting exposed to the next generation, and it changes what you have to look at. So I'm teaching now for the first time at the Jackson School of Global Affairs, the new school at Yale, and that's forcing me to confront negotiations over issues of global warming. Mm-hmm. And how do I take things that I understand about business negotiations and apply them to political negotiations?
Fantastic.
How well, sorry, one last question. How well attended are your classes?
Super well attended because they're required. So every student at the management school has to take the core negotiation course.
Got it.
And so I have, 360 some students a year.
Okay.
Fantastic. So on that, we're going to include all these great things in the show notes, folks. But the one thing I'd love for you to do is, where can people go to find out more about you, like websites, social channels, those kinds of things? Because I'm sure a lot of folks are going to want to go down the Barry rabbit hole.
Yeah. At the risk of hurting some book sales, you can go to splitthepiebook.com, and there's videos, there are interactive exercises, and there's also a free Coursera course on negotiation that I've created. And so you can take that along with the book. BarryNailbuff.com has references to my academic work. And the nice thing about a name like Nailbuff is if you Google it, not too many others are going to come up. Although, and if they are, they're related to me.
Fantastic. Well, thank you so much for coming on Forbes Obsessed. This is a great conversation, and I know the audience is going to love it.
Thank you for inviting me. And thank you for your grandma and making a tea lover out there.
Yeah, indeed.
Thank you for listening to Forward Obsessed. Please share this episode, subscribe, and leave a review on your podcast app. This episode was hosted by Pete Senna and David Salinas from the Digital Surgeons Podcast Studio in New Haven, Connecticut. Special thanks to our AV crew, Steve Walter and Meg Olson. Forward Obsessed is produced by Robert Roach. If you'd like to contact our team, visit us at forwardobsessed.com.